It gets so hard just trying to figure it out, fighting doubt, trying to believe God, trying to watch the words in my mouth and stay on.
So we're going to read together, but I want you to read. Wherever you are, read, but mute your mic. And it's from Colossians chapter 3. I'm going to begin now. Let us begin. Verse 1. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. Amen. Used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on a new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here, there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you are called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your heart. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You can stop here. You know, what I want to just briefly mention is the fact that we belong to God. We belong to God. When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you belong to God. You don't belong to yourself anymore. You can't just decide, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. You must now talk to God about what you do. And what I like about this chapter said, look here, because you belong to God, you have to now think of eternal things. Think about the things that pertain to the kingdom. Do not be preoccupied with earthly things. So listen, we live on the earth still, you know. So everything about eating and drinking and bathing and putting on clothes, God is not saying, remove yourself and go into a bush and don't wear and have on one suit of clothes all the time. That's not what he's saying. He said, do not let it preoccupy your mind. Set your mind on that which is above. He's also saying, we must learn to think heavenly, in a heavenly way. Let the unsaved be worried about what they're going to eat tomorrow and drink tomorrow. Let the unsaved people doubt and let them fear and let them think in their earthly way, but not for us, because we now belong to Christ. We're now surrendered to heaven, and we have to begin to think in a heavenly way. The verse we read also said, put aside the things you used to do, because now you belong to Christ. And he mentions a list of things. I don't know if you can bring it back up for me, Mr. Rowe. He mentioned a list of things that were to put aside. And some of these things give a lot of us problems. He said, put to death therefore whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Why? Because we belong to Christ. We have surrendered all to him now. And so must put aside these things. Sexual immorality. And God made sure he left this as a broad area. Because guess what? There are so many things included in sexual immorality. You have people teach you, for example, that the Bible does not mention that you cannot masturbate. But the truth is, it's included in a scripture like that. Sexual immorality. It includes homosexuality. It includes bestiality. It includes sex outside of marriage. It includes every sexual impurity. It includes pornography. All of this. And there's another word right afterwards, impurity, which also includes some of these things plus other things. Impurity. We must not practice impurity, impure thoughts, right? And then God emphasized even further, lust. And lust, by the way, is this kind of desire that controls you. And lust is not only about sexual lust, you know. You can lust after money. You can lust after a car. You can lust after a house. You can lust after a male or a female. It can be sexual lust too. You can lust after a big job. You can lust after anything. It is just an extreme desire that for something that God did not put in your way. That's lust. So, and he mentioned evil desires now, which incorporates some of all that we've said before, but adds other things to it. For example, you know, you can have an evil desire to see somebody who hurt you destroyed secretly. You might even voice it. You might not even say it out loud. Boy, I wish I could have get cancer dead. But it's in your heart, right? There's a scripture that should make us very careful. It's in Proverbs. I don't have the reference for it now. If it can be found before the end of the service, fine. It says that we should not gloat over somebody who has a misfortune, lest God turns around and puts it on us. So somebody does you something, and you, yeah, man, it's not now. Maybe it's not even a nice person. Maybe it's a wicked person. You know? And something bad up to them, them car crash and them paralyzed. Hey, me no man. Yes, because you see how them wicked ass there know that up to them. Me no business. And you know something? God said, don't gloat. Don't, yeah, man. No, don't gloat. That's what gloat means. You actually rejoice in that misfortune. Right? And God said, no. Right. See it here? It's 28:17, right? In Proverbs 28:17. Do not gloat when your enemy falls. Your own enemy. Don't gloat when the person falls. When they stumble, do not let your heart rejoice. There's another verse in the New Testament. It says, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. So a bad mind, a truth. A bad mind. Even in churches. Your friend get an A. I said, jump up and down and rejoice your friend. Your friend get a first class honors. No, sir. You might smile like, yeah, I got feel that. But in your heart, you're not rejoicing, you're not glad. You wish you were the one who got the first class honors, right? And God is saying, no. It's Romans 12:15. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Right? It's something that I practice. Do you know, jealousy is one of the biggest sins in the church, brethren? For example, I'm going to give you some examples that I've seen, and I'm seeing it even now in people's lives. When I go on Facebook, you see all the pastors I know, they're doing their pages and their stuff. I try as much as I can to like their pages, like what they're doing, type a positive comment. They might be doing a live. Type a positive comment, go girl, go. You see me? I don't see one of them put pressing the like button for me. Or even giving me a word of encouragement. You see, and if you share something, suddenly silence. You might send something into a group, something that you are doing, silence. When they send their thing in a group, I'm always quick to say, keep going on. Wonderful. I like this new area you're doing. That's how God wants us to be, you know. That's how God wants us to be. Encourage people and rejoice with them. Do not be jealous of them. Do not all of a sudden you're silent because it's not you. I know what God has done, brethren. I know in my heart. God has blessed this ministry with some excellence, some excellent ideas. You know, I like to punctuate my message. Sometimes I'm preaching. There's one that we did recently. It's a pastor developing, but I just love the thing. I don't know if you can bring it up, Mr. Rowe. What's his name? Dr. Strange. And I wanted to bring it up. I don't know if you can put it in YouTube. It should be in YouTube. But if you can't, if I know it's on Facebook, so chances are it's in YouTube as well.
I am going to get it. Give me a minute or so.
All right. So I'm just saying God gives us these ideas. And you know, when we have a pure heart, we share with the body of Christ. Not because we want more stuff in them, but because we want them to have the tools to serve the Lord, if he has blessed us with these gifts. And people are so, I mean, you think they say, well, thank God. No, sir. But I wanted to see Dr. Strange. I like Dr. Strange. Dr. Strange is kind of strange.
Let me tell you. I want to.
Wait, you can't show it full screen. I can't.
Why not? Appear things upon.
Wait. Ah, that's better. Let's look at Dr. Strange. I like this thing.
I hear you.
Well, Mr. Lee, I want you today.
Boy, doctor, appear things upon me head now.
Like what, so?
Boy, doctor, so my youth them in my community now move right, you know.
And how you want me if you fix that? Me's a medical doctor, me and a bush doctor.
Why them hard of hearing, some of them, you know. Want some pill if you fix them up.
What you need is a machine like this, yeah. If you do something to them head, pill can't help them.
You know you're right, doctor. You're sure you're not an appeal, though?
Look, come on. You is not the first, and you is not the last. You're going to come to me, and this thing work just like a charm. Better than a pill.
All right, doc. How it work?
Tough head machine.
Well, first you put the youth in the machine, and you press that big red button there.
I want this. I want God.
If I get out of hand, use that, it can lick him in the head. Make him keep still. Then he just give a couple seconds and him change totally.
Then, Mr. Sir, suppose some arm to him.
Then that you want? You want him change? Look, okay, man, enough youth. Me use this machine panel and it help them. Well, it changed them. I don't know if it helped them.
Sound dangerous though, Doc.
I am now an intelligent boy.
Ah! Arm to me!
We want me, mommy.
You see, that this alone can't help them, boy.
Then, Doc, what about the Bible of here people are talking about? Me say it work, you know. But me not too sure.
Well, if you tell the truth, me say it work, you know. Because enough of them youth, them see it change. But youth, them now on the word nowadays.
Repeat the Bible verse, Doc.
Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. It says, seek God first, and every other thing then come after.
Hope this work for me, Doc. Hope it work for the youth, them.
So you don't want to use my machine, my youth? You really rather use the Bible over my machine?
Mosquito try, doctor. And I bet it worked for me.
Don't wait too long. Cut the card before it's too late. Hold on. Let me come out of the box, yeah.
God.
Your mic is on mute, Pastor.
Muted, sorry. I'm convinced God gives these ideas and he gives them for the kingdom. And we must rejoice. As a pastor, I'm so happy when I see people in my church developing ideas. Because when we went into media, for example, I threw it out. I said, everybody, tap into your creativity and cope with ideas. and people started to come up with ideas, and I'm rejoicing. And I said, why, because I don't mean, you know, Apostle God need that. Me know, that, you know, I should have me God come in the ministry, and Apostle, that's not my way of doing things. I'm rejoicing, I know somebody of Christ. And I'm thanking God that he was good enough to give this idea to the ministry. That is to him. God gave it to him, but he gave it to the ministry. And I try to raise people up to realize it's not about you. There's another one I'd love to highlight as I go along. And you can bring it up. This one is in YouTube. It's one with the Stewart's family. It has a question mark in the middle. Found it? Where is our channel?
I'm going there now, Pastor.
Hi, I'm Jalen. And we're the
Start Over.
Today we're talking.
All right.
Hi, I'm Jalen.
And I'm Kieran.
And we're the Stewarts. Today we're talking about repentance.
What does it mean to repent?
Well, to repent means that you're turning from sin to God, and it's actually a 180 degree turn. So the changes that occur in a person's behaviors, thoughts, and attitudes are going to be drastic. So people are going to see that you have repented. It'll be obvious. John the Baptist said, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. So the fruit will be seen.
I don't have a thing. Why should I make a talk to me? I'm missing a thing there. I should have been doing a video. And then I'm a lead on the ministry. I saw them develop this product and I gave them my positive criticisms and, you know, they implemented some of my ideas and some of their ideas. And they came up with a product that I really, really like. And they were kind enough to give it to the ministry because that's how God works. We don't get jealous of each other, right? We rejoice with those who rejoice. We don't lust after power. We don't lust after greatness. We don't lust after limelight. You understand what I'm saying? And we use everything we have for God. That's what we should be doing. All our gifts and our talents, we should lay them at the altar. I don't know where I'm going. I'm going there. Do you know that every gift we have, we can choose to use it for ourselves? I can choose to use it for God. And, you know, I mean, my gifts, I give them to him. So what I do in Kairos, I could do in a secular realm and it profits me. Right? But that's not my desire. My desire not to do it in a secular realm and profit me. My desire is to lay it on the altar, and it so happens that our ministry is Kairos, and to let God use it through this ministry. Right? We will highlight one more of the things God has given us is the Caribbean News and Views. And we will highlight probably last episode is the political one. It's on YouTube for sure. And at least I think. Yes, it is. It is on YouTube, yes. And I just want to say, brethren, as he finds it, we give it all to the Lord. It is his. And while I'm doing this, I'm also encouraging you to share what God has given you, right? We're not going to play all of this, but what this is a news program. Make it up for me, sir. Greetings. We're here again. Caribbean News and Views. Elections are in the air, and you know, we've just settled the whole drama in Guyana. where, you know, the elections were in March, and it was just recently that they managed to install the prime minister. Trinidad had their elections without any fanfare or drama, we're happy to know. Now it's Jamaica's turn. And there are many people who think that Jamaica should not have called an election at this time, seeing that we're in the middle of the COVID-19 crisis. Now, Jamaica had been doing extremely well. We still are comparatively doing well. But recently, we really have been experiencing a spike. And in our country, an election triggers a lot of crowd behavior. Now, the politicians know that. And some people were saying, this should never have happened. O'Neill, I needed to weigh in on this for me. What are your thoughts?
I do agree that we could have afforded to wait, because constitutionally we're not due until next year to have an election. And it's interesting to note that both the Jamaica Medical Doctors Association and the Medical Association of Jamaica have issued press releases calling on both political parties to ensure that the protocols are adhered to because of the spike in cases that we're now seeing.
I heard from the pundit of one or another pundit that if the elections were not kept in early September, then there'll be a reducing chance of the Jamaica Labour Party, which is the incumbent party, winning the elections. So it was expedient that they call an election early.
But looking at it from a health point of view, from a, you know, the best interest of the country point of view, yes. I think in that sense, we could have waited, but...
Right. I understand what you're saying, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You should have realized it's not in the best interest of the people. That's what some people are saying, including myself. Because, you know, in Jamaica, election time is festivity time for a lot of people. A big campaign point, there are some who feel that every single politician is corrupt. I don't broad brush it like that. And some feel both parties have had corruption issues. Indeed, true. But I think what the Jamaican public is looking for is a party that will deal with corruption, who will tell them, yes, I am going to put an end to this. I think that's what I'm looking for. What about you?
I'm looking for the same thing, Pastor, because at the very basic of our upbringing is that once you do wrong, you're punished. And what we see happening, and happening for a long time, yes, but I mean... We don't really see the politicians who are caught doing wrong being punished. It has left a very bad taste in my mouth, and I can imagine a lot of Jamaicans.
Now, in our country, the difference in terms of policies and ideology between the two leading parties is not extreme.
Yeah.
So you find ideology is pretty the same, pretty much the same. There's no large socialist set of ideologies controlling any of the two parties. Free market economy, same policies on the Caribbean, etc., etc., etc. So the vote this time will not be any strong ideological kind of vote. It's going to be directed to what can you do to benefit the country? Will you do our roads? Will you service all our needs educationally? And as we said before, it will also involve the matter of corruption. Do you see any other issue that might play a role on you?
One big issue that has played a role is personality.
Individual personality and party personality. Yes. So the defining strategy in this year's election in Jamaica, you're not going to believe it. Remember, I said it's not a matter of ideology, right? It is the clash, the music clash,
yeah,
the songs.
Music clash.
It is whose songs are nicer. And I must say, I went through a list of them.
St. Andrew Eastern, Trayvon Williams, gotcha.
Watcha. Fable, them may want we ya. She cut and come back with the formula. Everybody speeches like Michael Jackson song.
police and I go bust them bubble and walk out everybody in a trouble and face have been up them a struggle them a cuddle Lisa make everybody just a grumble 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 and Lisa make Jamaica look good so decent and them a boom 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 Lisa body boom boom walk out Lisa your body boom 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 Lisa and none of them right now can defeat. Fix up the place, sent and look.
You can't stop there.
No long talking.
God.
You know, flight green.
You can't stop there. All right, thank you, Jesus. And what we left off the point that we are not jealous of each other. We work together for the kingdom's sake. Right? So it says, put to death whatever the lust, the evil desires, the greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways. So you used to be jealous of your friend, try to get up on top of everybody. You know, I'm me doing this and me. In the body of Christ, no. We do everything for the glory of God, right? So we used to be like that, but no, we're not. But no, you must rid yourself of all such things as these. Anger. I think Mr. Rowe left his position briefly. All right, anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Let me get it so I can read down on my own here. Give me a minute here, brethren. Pardon me. Just go down. Right. Right. So we must get from our lips all these things. It says slander, get anger, rage, malice. And I want to emphasize as we move down to the end of this, you know, there's the anger and rage. Anger, we all know what anger is, that feeling of displeasure. And actually, anger is not always sin. The Bible said, be angry and sin not. You can get angry. Anger is a natural human emotion that you can lead you into sin or lead you to righteousness. For example, you can get angry at sin and decide to go there and witness to people who are dying, or you get so angry at sin, you go into deep prayer and fasting. Right? Or you can get angry at sin and of course, have your neighbor. One of them is sinful, one of them is righteous. So anger can play a positive role in your life, a natural human emotion. But rage is when you're so angry, you lose your mind. I don't know if you've ever seen somebody who's full of rage. There's another scripture in the Bible that says that if you have rage, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And I find a lot of Jamaicans have rage. He said when they get angry, the anger turns up so much that they lose their minds. I've seen people full of rage. And while a lot of Jamaicans have rage, I have to honestly say a lot of Jamaican men trouble with rage. It's a very serious thing. You can kill people when you get into that thing. And when you're done, you're sorry, but it's done already. A lot of domestic abuse comes because of rage. You have to get rid of these things. Malice, we all know what malice is. Malice is like somebody I tell you, malice is actually a broad term that means when your attitude towards others is not one of love and purity. So if they do you something, you want to do them back something. Do something back to them. You can do something out of malice and spite. That God is saying, get rid of that. And get rid of slander. Slander is when you talk things about people that is not true. And do you know that many of us do it and we don't even know? Right? You know it's not true when you talk to. Sometimes you don't know if it's true or not. You're still talking. Slander is very painful. If you have ever had somebody say something about you and it's not true, and others believe them, you know how painful slander should be, is, and don't do it. Filthy language, bad word cussing, and other kinds of filthy language, expletives. Those got to get rid of them, you know. Got to play with filthy language. All those bad words is a curse. When you were not a Christian, don't try and justify it now and say, after the Bible tells us we can't see that. What's wrong with words? Words are just words. No. The Bible is very plain about putting away filthy language from your lips. and do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your own self. And by the way, lying only means those big obvious lies. You know, I earn $150,000 in my job. How much you earn? You know, say lie, you're telling me. But it also means when somebody say, when you go to church and you know, God touched me last night, boy. And you're doing an answer, you just want to see righteous. Lies come in all forms. And God is saying, put away lie. In fact, if somebody passes you, how are you doing? Be careful of your answer. Because you might say, everything is fine, I'm all right. When you know in your heart, you're so depressed. That's lying to you. That's lying too, right? So we must put out, stop lying to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices. And you put on a new self, which has been renewed in knowledge, in the image of the Creator. Wonderful. We have been renewed. You notice the tense there. It's a process. Right now, as I sit here, I'm being renewed. I'm not fully renewed yet, but I'm being renewed. You're being renewed. It's a process. And we're being renewed in knowledge in the image of the Creator. Isn't that a wonderful honor? So when it's finished, you and I are going to look like the image of the Creator. We're going to look like Him. That's why I have to bring us through all these things. Teach us how to wait and stuff. When things are happening immediately, bringing us through some hardships to shape us. And when you come into that image, He said there's no Gentile or Jew. Circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian. There's no American or Chinese. There's no rich or poor. There's no black or white. There's no Kingston people and rural people. No. There's no ex-prisoner and somebody who never go to prison yet. There's no hotty girl or ugly woman. There's nothing. We're all one. All one in Christ Jesus. If there's no normal person or a water hose, there is none. It's one. That's where we're headed. We're all one in Christ Jesus. Whether you come from downtown or uptown, you're one. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly beloved, clothe yourself with compassion. Because we belong to Jesus, God, help us to be compassionate. Help us to be kind. Help us to have humility. Help us to be gentle and patient and bear with each other. And forgive one another. Move up for me. And forgive one another. And forgive each other. Right? So we bear with each other. And forgive one another just as Christ forgave us. Right? And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together. I said, let the peace of God rule. Brethren, in church, we must have peace. Let's work for peace. Work for unity. And he said, be thankful. We must be thankful. And let the mission of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another. It's not just the pastor teaching. We're all teaching and admonishing one another day by day. That's what it's all about, right? And whatever you do, whether in words or deed, move it up a little for me, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through. So all these things we're producing, Dr. Strange, and our little videos to evangelize, and our news and views, and our messages we preach, and the dances we do, and everything is for the Lord Jesus Christ. We must honor Him. It's all about Him. It's not about us.
It gets so hard, just trying to figure it out, finding out, trying to believe God, trying to watch the words in my mouth and stay on the route. Trouble.